Belinda presents this unabridged recording of The Pictures, written by Guy Bolton and read by Adam Sims. Prologue. West Hollywood, Los Angeles, May 10th, 1939. The roads were busy for a Wednesday night. The evening sky was drawn and overcast, and most Angelinos were heading home before the rain came. In a radio car smelling of cheap coffee and paper bag dinners, Officers Becker and Cassidy took a disturbance call from dispatch, a last pickup 20 minutes before the midnight changeover. They were both local product, rare in the department, with over 30 years of service between them and a working partnership for almost half that. A disturbance report meant very little, but the address was a Tony neighborhood 3 miles west of Hollywood, and Becker suspected nothing more than a domestic dispute, maybe assault and battery if they were unlucky. He slouched in the passenger seat, his partner steering slowly and carefully down a row of detached houses surrounded by neatly sheared hedgerows and freshly trimmed lawns.
You got the house number?
110, looks like the third on the right. Becker peered through the windshield. A porch light revealed a woman sitting hunched on the steps leading up to the front door. They parked in the shadow of a coral tree, Becker pulling out his notebook before they'd even killed the engine. They could wrap this up in 15 minutes easy, type it up in the morning. They stepped out onto the asphalt, glancing sideways at the adjacent houses, noticing the curtains twitch, and a second later, the lights go out. This was a quiet neighborhood, and people weren't used to police cars pulling into driveways this late at night.
"You Mrs. Greer?"
Cassidy asked the woman. She looked to be 70 or so, with thin, almost wispy hair and sharp elbows hiding beneath a woolen housecoat. When they stepped closer, they could see her face was twisted in fright.
"Excuse me," Cassidy repeated. "Are you Dolores Greer? You called the police a few minutes ago?"
The woman looked at each of them in turn without recognition or surprise. She blinked several times but said nothing. Becker looked at Cassidy, then back again. He had to hide the irritation in his voice. "Ma'am, are you Dolores Greer? Did you call the police department about a disturbance at 110 Longbrook?"
"I called,"
she said at last.
"Something terrible has happened."
There was a shrill ring of fear in her voice.
"You live here? This your place?"
A shake and then a nod.
"This is my house. I own it."
"Can you tell us what happened? You reported a disturbance."
She looked back at the door and flinched, nervous by proximity. Exasperated, Cassidy lit a cigarette.
"Everything all right? You had an argument with your husband?"
"It's awful."
Her voice sounded like a child's whisper.
"Look at what they did. Dead. And for what?"
Becker's eyebrows arched. He wasn't sure he heard her correctly. He pointed his notepad at the doorway.
"Someone's died in the house? There's a body inside?"
"Yes,"
she said.
"Inside."
Becker pondered the possibility of murder. No, unlikely in these parts. He envisioned instead some old-timer rigored in his armchair. Mr. Greer, probably 80 years old, resting peacefully in a puddle of his own piss and shit. He turned to his partner.
"You want to stay with her?"
He went up without waiting for a response, stepping around the old lady as he made his way up to the front door. The screen door was wide open, the front door unlocked. Inside, the house was dark, with only a dull tungsten glow coming in from the front windows facing the street. He reached for the light switch and the hallway lit up. Becker left the front door ajar and moved through the house. The corridor was empty, but picture frames had been pulled off the walls, glass and wood laying across soiled footprints on the floorboards. There was a soft hissing sound like running water, but it didn't look like anyone was inside. Becker put his hand on his pistol and tilted his head back toward the front door.
"Looks like we got a robbery."
The first room he entered was the living room. The room had been turned over, that much was clear. The couch was cut open, more pictures broken from their frames. The floor was covered in shattered glass, and one or two of the floorboards had been jimmied up. He scanned the room, but there was no dead body. The kitchen was the same, drawers and cupboards torn open, but no corpse and no sign of blood. There was a bathroom at the end of the hall, some jewelry visible on a side cabinet, which seemed strange for a robbery. He found the source of the noise at the end of the hallway, outside what must be the bedroom. On a dresser was a phonograph, the needle prodding aimlessly at the end of the record. He left it there and approached the bedroom door, taking out a handkerchief to turn the knob. When the door opened, his stomach concaved. His heart rose in his chest, and he felt his pulse throbbing in his ears. For a long minute, he saw red spots and dark concentric circles. Dizzy, he steadied himself on the doorway. Officer Eric Becker had thought he was hardened to death. He'd lost two fellow officers in his tenure and believed he'd seen enough dead hoods and dope peddlers to keep his head at the sight of blood. He was wrong. The butchered remains of a pale, lithe body lay on a double bed in the middle of the room. A woman, if not a girl, was sprawled on her back, surrounded by a pool of coagulating blood. She was naked but for the tattered remains of a once white nightgown clinging to her midriff. Both arms and legs were extended into a spread eagle, her ankles and wrists trussed tightly against each of the four bedposts. Her pale limbs and torso were swollen and bruised, her neck crisscrossed from a ligature. But where the body's head should be, sat only a loose jaw with a small ovate hole in it. The body had no eyes, no nose, no face. The remains of her skull littered the pillow like bloody eggshells. Whoever she was and whatever she'd done to deserve such an end, the victim had been cuffed, beaten, strangled, and then finally killed. After the shock receded, Becker looked back through the door at the needle dancing on the phonograph. They must have played the music to drown out the screams. Chapter 1. Fred Astaire was performing at the Lilac Club. A black tie supper club on the eastern end of Sunset Boulevard, the Lilac Club was a venue synonymous with stars and stardom. It was owned by William Wilson, the wealthy publisher of the Hollywood Inquirer. Not content with running Hollywood's most popular trade newspaper, Wilson had bought several highly profitable clubs on the Sunset Strip, catering specifically to the Hollywood rich and famous. The Lilac Club was the largest and grandest of them all. Jonathan Craine was sitting at a table not far from the bar. Resisting the recent trend for white jackets, he wore a plain black New York drape suit with the legs tapered at the ankle. To look at, he was at once both appealing and unremarkable. Standing a little under 6 feet, Craine was fairly tall and reasonably broad, but not quite either. He remained to most people who met him quiet, measured, and reserved, a harmless nobody. The evening was in full swing, the room alive with chatter and laughter, but Craine sat alone. He bowed his head as a few familiar faces passed by, anxious to avoid their awkward nods and smiles. He tried to ignore the hushed whispers of strangers who knew him only by reputation, the hair standing tall on the back of his neck, as he imagined how they gossiped about the widower of the late actress Celia Raymond.
Detective Craine?
Craine looked up to see a waiter he recognized. Being referred to by his profession always put him on edge when he was off duty. Hello?
Good to see you again. Have you been away?
I was in New York. The waiter lowered his voice.
Are you back working the studios?
Craine was a little taken aback by the directness of the question, but he recovered his composure. No, he answered truthfully. I don't do that anymore.
Well, it's nice to have you back, sir. And I wanted to say...
The waiter paused, trying to find the right words.
I wanted to say I was very sorry about your wife. She was a lovely lady.
Craine tilted his head to acknowledge what he'd said, then replied simply, I'll have a French 75 whenever you're ready. The waiter stiffened. They returned to their roles as server and guest.
Oh, yes, sir, right away.
On stage, cheek to cheek was brought to an end, and the club audience broke into applause. A tall, olive-skinned man came on stage to shake Astaire's hand. The club manager, Benjamin Carell. They hadn't met before, but Craine knew he was a Chicago-bred Italian with criminal ties. He wondered why William Wilson had ever hired him.
Jonathan Craine? Detective Jonathan Craine?
He was expecting his cocktail, but when Craine turned around, the concierge was standing over him.
Yes, he said.
There's a call for you, sir.
Craine sighed. He knew exactly who it would be. Thank you, I'll be right over. Cancel my drinks order.
Yes, sir, right away.
Craine took the call at the front desk. Two studio executives were moving through the foyer, and Craine caught them staring at him. He heard his name mentioned, and one of them laughed. His ears burned, and Craine contemplated why, after almost 5 months away, he decided to come back from New York to a place that left him feeling injured and empty. This is Craine, he said after they'd gone.
Good evening, detective,
said a young man's voice. As expected, it was dispatch.
I apologize for calling you. Your secretary said you might be at the Lilac Club.
Yes, added Craine impatiently.
We have a report of a robbery-homicide in West Hollywood.
Who's on duty? I'm not due in until 9.
I'm afraid all our night officers are out on calls.
Craine sighed quietly. The homicide unit was understaffed and overstretched. It was little surprise Captain Sims had been so keen to have him back. Do you know the name of the first officer?
I'm sorry?
The first uniform officer on the scene.
1 second, please.
The line went quiet and Craine heard a ruffle of papers. Outside, 4 security guards pushed back a rank of photographers gathering beside the double glass doors. Craine followed their gaze. A woman entered the foyer and walked briskly toward the main hall. He recognized her as the actress Gail Goodwin. Her latest picture, The Tainted Feather, had topped the box office. She must be celebrating. The dispatcher came back on the line.
I'm sorry, I don't have that information, sir.
Craine rolled his eyes. Do you have the address?
Yes, detective, the address is...
Hold on 1 second. He cradled the receiver between cheek and neck and stretched across the desk for a pen and pad. Go on.
Address is 110 Longbrook Avenue.
Craine scrawled it down, then checked his watch. Just after midnight. He let out a long sigh. Tell the first officer I'll be there in 20 minutes. He put the phone down, rubbed his eyes, and asked the concierge to retrieve his coat and hat. A gray and dusty Los Angeles reeled through the windows like a broken strip of celluloid. Although the motion picture industry had helped prop up Los Angeles in the lean years since the Wall Street crash, visible shocks of depression were not in short supply. Craine wound up the window as he drove past a slum of tar paper shacks and a group of homeless men fretting over a garbage fire. He passed vacant lots and filling stations, mile after mile of billboards selling God, bank loans, and beauty creams. He accelerated west down Sunset before turning south toward Hollywood, the neon nightlife receding in his rearview mirror. He was driving the V16 Cadillac Fleetwood that Celia had bought him for their 10-year anniversary. The car radio was playing an Ella Fitzgerald record, and he turned it up so loud that thoughts of Celia were buried in the song. The slum receded, quickly forgotten to palm trees, flowering plants, and the stucco-walled homes of the Hollywood middle class. This is a city of contradictions, Craine thought, a metropolis where sepia and technicolor play side by side. He turned into Longbrook, where the roads were quiet now, almost empty, with barely a Buick or Packard in sight. Craine looked at the address dispatch had given him, counting the house numbers on his right. He spotted a squad car parked outside a single story and pulled up behind it in the driveway. The porch light flicked on and the front door opened. A squat uniform officer with a thick mustache and a flashlight cradled under one arm stepped outside.
Evening, detective,
he said as Craine got out of his car. His eyes widened when he caught a glimpse of the Fleetwood, but he kept his thoughts to himself. He probably thought all detectives drove $2,000 Cadillacs. You the first officer?
Yes, sir, Becker. Arrived about an hour ago. My partner Cassidy went to take a statement from the neighbor. She called it in.
Craine took a pencil and notepad from his jacket pocket. Did you touch the body, move it at all?
Didn't get further than her doorway.
A woman?
Yes, sir. Shot dead.
He sighed inwardly. A girl dead meant unwanted media interest. Craine paused to examine the door and windows on the front of the house. All intact.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.